on today's show.
Handsome Chandler Parsons has another setback. The Jazz and Clippers get a little physical. And Ricky Rubio sets a Wolves record.
In Crossfire, we dream up the first round matchups we'd like to see and make our March Madness picks.
And we debate which NBA player is most likely a wizard.
It's Tuesday, March 14th. The Starter starts now.
Good evening, Sweet World, and welcome to The Starters. Whether you're listening to the podcast, joining us live right now on NBA TV, or a little bit later on YouTube, we're very, very happy to have you. Jay Skeetson alongside me. As always, that's Tass Mellis.
Cell phone reminder, everyone.
To his right, the international man of mystery, taking it to the max, Lee Ellis.
Brennan.
Lily. And last, certainly not least, over there, it's the bearded one. It's Trey Kirby.
Ayo!
TK, what's up?
Well, I'm here at the internet looking for your best tweets at #TheStarters. And guys, one of the biggest names in college basketball this year is Lonzo Ball, but one of the biggest talkers in college basketball is his dad, LeVar Ball, whose incredible claims have made just as many waves as his son's play. His latest is no different. This comes to us from Josh Peter at USA Today. LeVar said, back in my heyday, I would kill Michael Jordan one-on-one, even adding, he cannot stop me one-on-one. Okay, buddy. But this brings us to today's question. What preposterous NBA claim do you like to make? For instance, I like to tell people that during my senior year of high school, I led all of Illinois in blocked shots, despite the fact that the number one recruit in the nation, Eddie Curry, was in my graduating class, despite the fact that there were several future NBA players playing in Illinois at that time, and despite the fact that I looked like this during high school.
Look at those tiny feet! Yeah.
Tiny feet, crazy wingspan, good luck finding the stats to disprove my claim, it's still true. But we want to hear from you, so let us know on Twitter, what's a preposterous NBA claim you like to make? Send us your best tweets to #TheStarters, and we'll hear from you later.
Might have a Skip Bayless situation on our hands.
I was blocking it like crazy, Tass.
I believe it.
Get those tweets in. Those should be fun. All right, we got a fun show tonight. Tass and I will go head-to-head in Crossfire, and we'll have a little fill-in-the-blank fun. But we start with a little what you got. If you're new to the show, Trey presents us with some related topics. We'll debate the better choice. The catch, though, there's only one right answer, and that's whatever TK thinks it is. First one.
That's right. The Grizzlies announced yesterday that Chandler Parsons is out indefinitely with a torn meniscus in his left knee. We're going to find out later this week if he needs season-ending surgery. Unfortunately, Parsons is just the latest member of the 2016 free agent class to be shut down, joining the Knicks' Joakim Noah, who had knee surgery, and Timofey Mozgov, who's been shelved by the Lakers while they look at younger players. Guys, who's the most disappointing signing? Parsons, Noah, or Mozgov? What you got?
Wow. I think it's Joakim Noah, because I held out hope that Joakim would be the glue that would hold that New York Knicks team together. And no amount of meddling or ineptitude in the locker room would be able to break the glue and the bond that Joakim Noah would bring to this team. But as we know, a lot of other things happen in that franchise. And Joakim Noah really just didn't look like Joakim Noah at all. So I had more hopes for that entire team, and the entire team has been a disappointment, you know, to compound Joakim Noah's injuries.
Yeah, to be disappointed, you have to have high hopes in the first place. And Noah, I did have high hopes. I thought a fresh start, going to New York where he was born and he spent some time growing up as a kid, this could reinvigorate him, but hasn't been the case. It's been a pretty bad season for the Knicks and a pretty bad season for Noah. And hopefully he can come back next season and be better.
I think you can make a case for any of these three guys, but yeah. I'll go with Chandler Parsons, because this news now, the third knee injury in 3 years, two on one knee and now one on the other knee. This is bad, bad news. And this is a guy signed a $95 million deal. That's more than the other two guys. I mean, maybe that comes into play here when you're trying to pick most disappointing. They thought the Grizzlies, when they were getting him, hey, we finally are getting a wing guy that can maybe step out and hit a three and maybe facilitate the offense and help Conley out a little bit. And he just can't stay healthy. He really, really can't. It's unfortunate, but it's terribly disappointing. You have to start wondering. I know he's still young, but is he sort of the next Brandon Roy here with these sort of injuries that he just has a very, very short career? Well, that's sort of where we're getting at with Chandler Parsons. I know he's going to do his best to get back out there, and hopefully he will, but That's a huge bummer for them.
I mean, the Mavericks kind of let him go, and they knew
yep.
that he'd had problems with his knees. And this is why I think Mark Cuban was happy to say, you know what, you can go on someone else. Someone's to pay you that sort of money. I'm not interested in matching it, because he's had these problems in the past. And you mentioned he's a young guy, but knee problems, meniscus tears.
Right.
Oh, they have a habit of lingering around. And you mentioned Brandon Roy. I mean, he lost all his meniscus, still tried to play, and he couldn't. So hopefully it doesn't turn out that bad for Parsons.
All right. Yeah,
and I guess the other sort of part about Joakim Noah's injury is that he's on the other side of 30, and this seemingly was his last hope to be that old Joakim Noah, which wasn't that old. I mean, it was only a few years ago. But if you're on the other side of 30, unlike Parsons, who's younger, is there really any hope that Joakim Noah can be a real potent starter in this league again?
We've
debated that. I highly doubt it.
All right, so we're split a little bit on this one. Trey, what's the answer?
I'm with Tass. I'm going with Joakim Noah because of the age. He's 32 years old. Signed to a 4-year deal, yikes. Couple of big wins in the playoff seeding game last night in Utah, a game chock full of playoff atmosphere. The Jazz took down the Clippers in what might have been a first round preview, and in Minnesota, the Timberwolves rode strong performances from the Big Cat and Pretty Ricky to a win that leaves them 3.5 games out of 8th in the West. Guys, what was the bigger win? The Jazz or the Wolves? What you got?
The Wolves. They're still in it.
Mm-mm.
In the playoff hopes.
A little
three
too
and
late.
A half games
it's
back.
It's a little too late, man.
But listen, they're playing the right way right now. They're doing all these things. They're getting... That was like a playoff-type atmosphere against the Wizards, who are red hot right now last night. They had to win. They went out and did it. Karl Anthony Towns again has been fantastic.
I'm sorry to jump in here. Listen, that was a schedule loss for the Wizards.
No, well,
it was the last
doesn't
game.
Matter, it doesn't matter. They've been playing really well. And the
Lee,
thing is,
Lee
was
the
Jazz
one.
Are
Lee
already
the
in
Wizards.
The playoffs right now. The Jazz and the Clippers are in the playoffs. So it doesn't really matter about seeding.
You don't think home court advantage matters?
It's important, especially for a young Jazz team? But it's more important for the Timberwolves if they can get into the playoffs and get any sort of experience.
Yeah, look, a big win, and they've been playing great from the All-Star break, and Rubio's been solid. And if you watched the game last night, Karl Anthony Towns was an absolute beast.
He's been on fire.
He's a beast. And they're playing defense that we thought they would play under Thibodeau. It's finally come around. Excited for next year, as I always am with the Timberwolves. It's going to be a little too late, I think. I think the Jazz win was huge for that team. The Clippers have owned them over the last couple of years. They had lost 16 to 17 games against LA. They were down again last night, Utah was, against Clips, and they came back. They hit some crazy shots. Yes, Joe Johnson had a couple unbelievable miracle shots. George Hill hit some huge ones late. That's a big win for a very, very young team that is going to be in the playoffs, which is great, and needs home court advantage, in my mind, to have any chance of even beating a Clippers team.
Yeah, and quite...
So that's big.
And quite likely would be a first-round matchup.
Probably.
The Jazz against the Clip. And not only do they win, they won with Chris Paul scoring 33 points.
Yeah.
So I think that can be a focus going forward. We can prohibit Chris Paul from scoring 33. We still have things to grow on. And you're right. This is just a confidence builder.
I would add, no favors in this as well, which you think Blake Griffin would take huge advantage of. Gordon Hayward did a great job when he was matched up on him, keeping him in check. That's a big doubt. And in a tiebreaker situation, because they have one more game, the Clips took the first two, Jazz took last night. If the Jazz win that fourth game, they'll likely have the tiebreaker because they'll be the division leader. So that could be huge.
Gordon Hayward said he bulked up. He said he wouldn't be able to match Blake Griffin a couple of years ago, but he got a little bulky.
Maybe
girthy Boris Diaw has rubbed off on him this year. But the Timberwolves, the fact is, some teams just take them lightly. And I know
but
you...
Not lightly. They've been playing really well.
I know, but that just happens in March.
What are they supposed to
There's
do?
There's only one right answer.
Season.
There's only one right answer, man. It's whatever that guy says it is. What's the answer?
I'm going with the Timberwolves.
No, get out of here. That's a wrong answer,
They're
man.
In a playoff race.
Exactly.
Every win matters. But guys, grab your glasses. We got some nice passes. Tricky Ricky threw a 40-foot bounce pass to notch his 10th assist of the first quarter last night. Finished with 19 for the game. And the Joker, Nikola Jokic, threw an over-the-head no-looker to a cutting Will Barton for the slam jam. Guys, what was the better dime? Rubio or Jokic? What you got?
Are any of these getting very solid play?
Nah, they're too sexy, both of them.
Oh, no, these are too sexy.
Yeah.
I think it's the Rubio one. These are both great passes, but I think the Rubio one is the better dime. I think it's just much more difficult pass to
Definitely
on the
more
fly
difficult, for sure.
Between three guys.
Yeah.
And maybe I'm also taking into consideration that Rubio set a franchise record last night with 19 assists in the game. He had 10 in the first quarter. You know, people were getting excited on Twitter for a little bit, like, whoa, Scott Skiles, crazy 30-assist game. Might be in jeopardy. It obviously wasn't, but... That's a crazy, crazy pass. I'll go with Rubio.
Yeah, I mean, Jokic looked like Sabonis or Marc Gasol, one of those old European dudes who can just throw the ball over their head and find a guy cutting. It was a beautiful pass.
So you go with that one?
No, I'm not going with that one. I'm going with Rudy.
You love a bounce pass.
I do. I love a high-speed bounce pass, but that's just beautiful. We've seen this stuff from Nikola Jokic all season long. You're
bored already?
No, not bored. I enjoy seeing it, but Rubio's on the bounce on the fly was the better pass.
Tass, you got to decide this.
What shall I do, Skeets?
Oh, you're torn.
I'll go Rubio as well. It felt a little bit more like a planned pass. I mean, Jokic is obviously, he knew where the rebound was coming and that there was a guy there, but yeah, Rubio felt a little.
Trey, what's the answer?
I agree, guys. Ricky Rubio, a long bounce pass. Not many things better in the league.
I thought you might go with the big guy, though. You know.
I'm like, Lee, I'm bored already. Okay. We've seen it so many times.
He's so good.
Who needs to even look anymore?
Yeah, all right. Take a break. When we come back, Tass and I will go head-to-head in hopefully a heated round of Crossfire. Don't go anywhere. You're watching The Starters.
Crossfire! Woo! Welcome to Crossfire. This is how it works. Trey will give Skeets and me three topics. We'll debate each one. At the end of it all, Trey will declare a winner. Trey, what's our first topic?
All right, round one. After last night's Clippers-Jazz game, this dude is ready for some playoffs. And with less than 5 weeks until the postseason, things are getting a bit clearer. So, guys, what's your most anticipated first-round series? Here we go!
Give me Rockets-Thunder in the 3-6 seeding format. Couple reasons why, Tess. Couple reasons why. One, they have played some very close games this year already. Three games, all of them decided by 3 points or less. They're a nice clash of styles. You got Houston as your offensive juggernaut. OKC a little more defensive minded. And oh yeah, Harden, Westbrook, one of them could be the MVP. Possible seven games of those guys going back and forth, trading triple doubles. Give me that series, Rockets Thunder.
I love your Thunder pick, but why not put them against Kevin Durant and the Golden State Warriors? They could easily play at the 2-7 spot.
The Warriors will crush them.
No. This is Kevin Durant versus Russell Westbrook the year after Kevin Durant left Russell. How many games are we gonna see Russell try and shoot 40 times? But if that doesn't work, Russell scale it back and pass the ball. I think it'll be a fantastic series, no matter how you slice it. I don't think Russell try and shoot every single possession, but this is the year. After KD left, OKC's building will back Russell Westbrook. What a mess.
So you want 2-7 series there.
Exactly.
Give me 3-6.
All right. Round two coming up. Last night, Vince Carter scored 24 points on 8-of-8 shooting, including 6 threes. Which are the most ever by a player in his 40s. Guys, with that in mind, who's your favorite old guy ever? Here we go!
Kevin Willis is my oldie. He was part of the 1984 infamous draft. I didn't really appreciate him until the late 90s, because he's one of those 90s guys, you know? Yeah. He lay down the wood if you come into the lane. I didn't really appreciate him until the late 90s when he joined the Raptors. He was traded from the Raptors when he was 38 in 2001. Then he played another 5 seasons.
Played a long time.
He retired when he was 44, and he had an early birthday. If only he had an early birthday, he would have been 45. Kevin Willis, Mr. Oldie.
I don't mind that pick, but we all know old guys come best in pairs. Statler and Waldorf, Jack Lemmon, Walter Matthau. Stockton and Malone, baby. Give me two guys for the price of one here, Tassie. During the 2001 season, Stockton and Malone combined for 36 points per game, 12 boards per game, and 12 assists per game. They were 39 and 38 years old, respectively. They were putting up PERs of over 20. And then they would do it again the next year when they were even older. Those guys were unbelievable.
Come on, Kevin Willis was the Chris Chelios of the NBA.
What about Julio Franco?
Let's think of old athletes.
All right, round three. Yeah. Guys, it's tourney time!
Yeah, college basketball! Yeah,
we don't know anything about the NCAA, but who is your March Madness pick? Here we go!
All right, well, a little research shows that a 16th seed has never beaten a number one seed. Until this year, when the South Dakota
State... What are their names?
Jackrabbits!
Yeah!
The
go
South
Rabbits!
Dakota State Jackrabbits, they do the impossible. All right, they're on a roll. They got a guy named Mike Dom.
Cool!
The Dominator, scoring 25 per game.
Here we go,
Dom. Won 9 of their last 11. They're going to upset Gonzaga. You heard it here first. Put it down in pencil and pen in your bracket thing there. Don't look at my sheet.
Just like your two old guys, I'm giving you two for the price of one. Woo! This is the year of the dog. The dog wants some revenge. Why does the dog want some revenge? Because we could have the first president to not have a dog as a pet in nearly 130 years.
What?
That's why the Gonzaga Bulldogs and the Butler Bulldogs will both make the Final Four.
Wow, two Bulldogs.
And only one can make the final, because apparently they meet in the Final Four. Give me the Gonzaga Bulldogs.
So we're going head to head in the first round. Jack Rabbits
and Gonzagas.
Yeah.
Who's going to win?
Today's winner, GSD!
Let's go, Jack!
That's a Mike Dom pick right there.
Oh, man. All right, we got to take a break. Lots more still to come on the show. Like, who is the NBA's wizard? That's a question we're asking. Don't go anywhere. We're fired up today. Welcome back to the Starters. Let's have a little fill-in-the-blank fun. Trey, set us up.
All aboard the Hogwarts Express! After being hit with a flying object, former NBAer Luigi Datome was left with a lightning bolt-shaped gash above his eye that had everybody thinking he looked like Harry Potter, which is exactly why he tweeted, "Please tag me and J.K. Rowling with the picture. It's the only chance I have to know her." To which J.K. Rowling herself replied, "Just seen this. For the record, nobody needs a lightning-shaped cut to the head to meet me. Get well soon. Y'all know I love me some Harry P." So fill in the blank, the NBA's most likely wizard is blank.
Kyrie Irving. Mm. There's magic in those handles, man. The stuff this guy does, what feels like every second night in terms of dribbling the basketball, that's a wizard. That is an NBA wizard.
No, he's doing it against the Wizards.
It's crazy. It's crazy. I gotta go with Kyrie, man. What about you guys?
I'm actually going with Vince Carter, because the definition of a wizard is someone who has magical powers.
Yeah.
And
oh,
I believe,
you don't say.
And I believe he has magical leaping powers. This is him 40 years old yesterday, throwing down a reverse. I mean, he's 40 years old and he can do this. Not many of us could do this in our prime. Some of us could.
You make it sound like you can.
Yeah, well, I mean, something similar to that anyway, you know. But look at that, 40 years old. He's
wild.
A wizard for sure. He said he's going to play one more season already as well. So we've got one more year of these amazing dunks.
All right. Yeah,
he told us he's going to get to his 20th year. You're 40. You can't.
I mean, maybe if I got in the gym and worked out a little, but
maybe a tennis ball.
You do bar three nonstop. You don't stop talking about it.
Yeah. I'm not 6'8", though.
Okay.
Oh, man. 6'6". He's 6'6". I'm picking Jonas Valanciunas, because he was a wizard.
What do you mean?
Back in 2012.
What?
The Lithuanian All-Star Game, before he came to the NBA. Not only did he score 25 points in the game, but at halftime he dressed up as a wizard.
Well, it checks out.
That looks like a wizard to me.
For sure.
Charles Barkley would call him Jonas Valanciunas Wand Sauce. Boo.
Next one.
All right. Last night, the Raptors beat the Mavericks, and they also scored 100 points. So you know what that means. Late in the fourth quarter, it was pizza time, and no one was more excited than Raps color man Jack Armstrong.
178.
Slice of life, Matty D. Late night slice.
Fill in the blank, a better arena giveaway would be...
No one better than Jack Armstrong.
What do you got, Lee?
A whole pizza. Give him the whole pizza. Not just one smelly little slice.
Yeah.
I got something better, Lee. Something you're going to like, I think. All right? Here's what happens. There's a very solid play.
Right.
Okay? The fans go nuts. Wow, that looked very solid.
Oh,
and then they give out these very solid shirts and they just start throwing them out to everybody. Who wants one? Who wants a double XL, triple XL? There you go, Carlos.
Skeets, you hate when arenas give out large shirts.
What
Those
you
are
mean?
Monstrous.
You're a big guy, Tessie.
Oh, yeah.
You can wear
I'm
one.
A triple
hey,
X.
Somebody.
Hey.
Oh, these smell like vinegar.
They do smell like vinegar.
I'm going with Ricola, hand out cough candies to all the fans to keep their throats in prime yelling form. Smart.
Final one, Trey.
All right, forget Pi Day and National Learn About Butterflies Day. That's a real thing. March 14th is Stephen Curry's birthday. And since Steph has brought us so much joy these past few years, I thought it might be nice to return the favor. So guys, fill in the blank. The best way to wish Steph Curry happy birthday is...
Only one way to do it.
Yep. Sing a song.
Sing a song.
Sing a song. Sing a song.
All of us going with sing a song. Of course, though, not from us.
No.
No, no. If you're going to sing a song to Steph Curry on his birthday, it has to come from Steph's biggest fan. Happy birthday, Steph.
Stephen Curry,
and the Warriors.
Stephen Curry, he's driving me crazy. Stephen Curry,
and the Warriors.
Stephen Curry, he's driving me crazy. Huh? Who is this kid? Have you seen this kid? Have you seen what this kid did? Guess what? This kid can shoot the ball from anywhere. I mean it, he can shoot it from your chair. And if you don't believe me, turn on your TV, then you'll see. Stephen Curry,
in the Warriors.
Oh, boy. It's so catchy, man.
He'd still be there now, that guy, if the camera was rolling.
Oh, for sure. The Warriors. Catchy, man. All right, one more break when we come back. Lily's very solid play. We asked you, what's a preposterous NBA claim you like to make? You hit us up on Twitter, #TheStarters. Trey has a few of the best answers.
Yeah, some good ones. Will Burns says that he'd be the best free throw shooter in NBA history because he went in intramurals, went to the line once and made both. Preposterous indeed. B-Matt says he thinks Rudy Gay is better than Scottie Pippen and argues with his friend about it all the time.
What?
Your friend is right. And Gustavo says he thinks that Lee Ellis could shoot 40% on threes. That's actually true. I think that's actually true.
I don't know. That's preposterous. It'd be 45.
last night's pick'em results, it was the Wizards and Wolves. Lee was the only one to take Washington. Bit of a schedule loss there, Lee. You are in last place for the month of March. Tonight's game, it's the Blazers and Pelicans. Lee and I have the Blazers. Tass and Trey have the Pelicans at home. Good luck to everybody. Lee? Where are we going for VSP?
We're going to Toronto for another old man who could be a wizard because of his magical shooting powers. It's Dirk Nowitzki, a beautiful netball play here. Nice. Back at the top for our
swish ball.
Oh, yeah. Here it is again. Dirk still giving it out at this age. He's nearly 40.
One.
Beautiful stroke there. Beautiful finish. That's what I call a very solid shirt
and
play. I'll send one to you, Dirk. He's already got one of the generic ones, but we'll give him that as well.
All right, on today's Twitter show, we played How Worried Are You? We debated which NBA family would do best on Family Feud, and we flexed our superior March Madness knowledge.
What was that one team that was doing it like crazy?
Monmouth?
Monmouth? I don't know.
Oh, yeah,
Who was it?
Yeah, Monmouth.
You got something in your Monmouth.
M-O-N-M-O-U-T-H, however it's pronounced.
Monmouth.
These words are coming from Monmouth.
Isn't it just Monmouth?
I don't know.
The myth, the legend, Monmouth.
We know so much about college sports. It's crazy. Tonight on NBA TV, Fan Night doubleheader, Pistons and Cavs, followed by Sixers and Warriors. Lee, I think we got some time for some fan signs here.
David Preston and his wife were at the Wolves and Warriors game on Friday night, and they saw a big win for the Wolves.
Big sign.
Kristen was at the Rockets and Cavs game on Sunday night, and he wants a piece of JD and Trey because he's got a big beard and he's coming for TK and TD. And the last one comes from the second grade boys at Cincinnati Country Day School.
That's nice.
Together, a very nice sign. Thanks, guys.
All right, guys, we'll see you tomorrow night, 7 p.m. Eastern.
Thanks for joining us, and remember, there's a doubleheader tonight on NBA TV.
Brace the night, people.